So basically the size center is basically used to measure the unknown angle with respect to the tapered cross sectional area. So basically what we speak about the aim of the experiment itself is that to measure the unknown angle of the tapered specimen. So in the with respect to the size center, we'll always use with respect to the conical surface. So the conical surface will have the two kinds of diameters, right? So one will be the smaller diameter and one will be the larger diameter. So the experiment itself, let us see about what is the different what are the different concepts of the sine bar and the sine center itself. So let me take an example of a sine bar here. So I have the sine bar which have the absolute of two rollers here, wherein the axis of the roller is perfectly parallel to each other, and we have the few amount of distance between the two rollers itself. That is what we call as the gauge length. So the gauge length is basically the distances between the central axis of both of the rollers here what we have, and these rollers will be perfectly parallel to each other, and will always make the horizontal surface of the table itself will be perfectly parallel to the horizontal surface also, to the ground also. So basically we will conduct the experiment with respect to the sine bar and the sine center, and the working principle will be same, and the differences lies in between the specimen, the kind of specimen that we use. The specimen that we use here is nothing but the conical surface, and for the conical surface, as we see, we have the two kinds of diameter. One is the larger diameter and the other one is smaller diameter. So for the in order to find the taper angle for such of the conical surface, we always use the formula tan theta, that is equal to larger diameter minus smaller diameter. That is what I can speak about, the small capital letter D and small letter D. So D minus D divided by 2L. So L being the length of the specimen itself, right? So for finding the taper angle, we will use the same formula itself, and the same formula can be used as a reference to find out what might be the approximate angle of such of the conical surface here. So for that, we'll take the dimensions of the larger diameter and smaller diameter of the conical surface here. Then we'll take the values into consideration for the tan theta formula. Then we'll get the theta approximate value. So for the theta approximate value, we'll can use to calculate the same formula using the sine theta p, sine theta actual approximate is equal to h approximate divided by lc. So lc here is nothing but the gauge length, of the sine bar or the sine center. So that is what I call as the differences between the central axis of two rollers itself. So as we speak about the sine theta p, with the sine principle, sine theta approximate, we have the approximate value of tan theta p. The same theta p can be applied here for the approximate angle, and we can able to find out what might be the approximate height. So approximate height can be given by lc into sine theta approximate. So let us take an example that we have the sum amount of value with respect to the D. So if we can able to put the value of 24 mm and the 11 mm being the largest diameter and the smallest diameter here, and the length of the specimen might be of 50 mm, then possibly we will get the theta approximate value itself as 7.4 degrees. If we can able to apply the same formula, same value to the formula, sin theta approximate equals h approximate divided by lc, so we can able to find out the h approximate value. In this case it is 25.759 mm. So this will be the approximate height. So the next step itself is to find out what might be the exact amount of unknown angle for that conical surface. So for that, we take the h approximate value into the consideration. For the same value, whatever we get, we use to build up the slip gauges with the different combinations. Using the different standards of slip gauges also used to build up, and we use the same sine bar into the consideration itself. So let me take an example of a sine bar here. As I said, so both of the rollers are perfectly parallel to each other. Suppose if the ground is of absolutely parallel to the horizontal surface here, then we can place the sine bar on top of that, then use to build up the height at only at one end. So let us say that the specimen is of the tapered one. In that case, we will use to measure what might be the irregularities present on the surface itself. Suppose if that kind of surface is of the tapered one itself. Let us take in consideration that possibly at one end of the surface you might have the smaller amount of length, and the other end of the surface you might have the larger amount of length. That means the surface is constantly varying over the length itself. In that case, we'll use the dial indicator, which have the certain pointer and the graduation markings upon the dial indicator here. So whenever used to move the pointer around to the upwards, we can able to see that on the pointer itself, it can able to take the deflection upon the pointer itself to the either might be of the to the clockwise direction, or it might be to the anti-clockwise direction. Let us take an example that if the pointer is been moving upward, the deflection is been taking with respect to the clockwise direction. Okay. If the surface is of the perfectly parallel, if it is of the perfectly horizontal to the surface itself, in that case, if if at all we want to do the same kind of tail indicator on the top of that surface, probably there won't be any kind of deflection that might be occurring on the pointer. If there are any kind of irregularities that have been present on the surface, say for example we have the one amount of height at the one end and possibly at the other end more the length, there might be increase, gradual increase of height itself. In that case, if at all you want to move the dial indicator from one point towards to the other point, obviously there has to be the irregular surface here. Then with a changing in surface over the duration of length, then possibly the pointer will actually take some kind of graduation deflection over the graduation readings. So we can take, either it might take the course of action with respect to the clockwise direction, the movement of deflection, or it might be with respect to the anti-clockwise direction. Let us take that you are moving the pointer from left direction to the right direction and the pointer is been showing with respect to the clockwise direction, clockwise deflection. So it means to say that the surface has been gradually increasing from left to leftwards towards to the rightwards. And we are going to increase the height of the specimen at the one end, so that at some point of time the specimen height will actually become exactly parallel to the horizontal surface. So in that case, if at all you want to move the dial indicator on the top of that surface, then probably you might not feel any kind of deflection upon the graduation readings. Suppose, let us take that if at all you increase this height to the furthermore extent and if it goes beyond to the value of h approximate value that you got here, then possibly instead of getting the clockwise direction of the deflection in the pointer here, you might have to get the anti-clockwise deflection itself. Then possibly you can take that kind of deflection might be with respect to the increasing height itself. So we will go by the trial and error method and used to measure what might be the approximate height that required for the deflection to be absolutely zero. So for that case, we will always increase the height at one end and we will make the surface or the table surface itself as parallel to the horizontal plane or the horizontal table. So for that case, we will always take the deflection and we will always go by different readings with respect to that. So let us assume that at some point of time and for some height, you will make the value h actual itself as 0. That means the deflection that you are getting for the value itself as 0. So that will be taken as h actual and that will be applied for the formula sin theta actual is equal to sin theta h actual divided by LC. Of course the LC value will remain the same and the theta actual will have to find out here. That is what we call as the unknown taper angle. So using the same principle, sin theta is equal to opposite by hypotenuse. In that case, if I can be able to apply the sin theta actual is equal to h actual divided by LC, h actual being the final amount of height that you got during the trial and error with respect to the different amount of readings here. So that we will get the value here. So theta actual is equal to sin inverse of h actual by LC. So finally we will get the theta actual value. So all you have to do here is nothing but have to compare the basic angle between and the differences of angle between the theta approximate and as well as theta actual. So almost in most of the cases the similarities will be the same, but there will be some kind of deviation that might occur here. So possibly because of some errors or possibly because of some kind of changes in the changes in the measurement that you are doing here. Okay. So as we speak about the sine bar and the sine center, both of the experiments will be used to find out the unknown angle with respect to the table surface here, and this is what we call as the device that we use for the sine bar. So similarly, for with an extra arrangement and with the extra auxiliary equipment, we used to have the sine center, and the only differences here is nothing but for the sine bar we have the tapered cross section area with respect to the specimen, and for the sine center we have the conical surface. Okay. And obviously the sine bar has been made up of the high carbon steel and high chromium steel, which is of the corrosion resistance itself and it is of the toughened one also. So possibly you can able to find out the different amount of relief force in between the gauge length here. So that is to relieve the stresses that has been occurring in that one, and also to avoid the bending stresses that has been applied whenever you apply the load on the top of the sine bar. So this is the working principle of the sine bar, and let us move to the working environment and we shall see what kind of equipment that we use and what are the procedures to follow to take up the readings. So for that we can able to use the sine center itself to conduct the experiment for finding the unknown angle with respect to the taper surface here. So at the initial step we used to take the readings off using a vernier caliper using for the larger diameter for at the one end
for the larger diameter, and we used to take the readings with respect to the smaller diameter also. Okay, so that will be the smaller, the big letter D, and this is the small letter D. So that will be applied to the formula tan theta is equal to D minus D divided by 2L. So we'll get the approximate value of theta here. So using that approximate value of theta, we used to get the theta approximate. So that will be applied to the sine center. Sine theta approximate is equal to H approximate divided by LC. So by that we'll get the approximate height. So now we'll take the combination of slip gauge for that, and we used to take what might be the approximate height for that one, and we used to build up the combination of slip gauge, then we'll run the dial indicator readings upon that one. So before to that, let me explain the concept of the dial indicator here. As I said, so the dial indicator will be placed at the one end, and it has to move to the other end here. As you can see, while moving to the different conical surface onto the different taper surface here, you can able to observe there might be a readings or the fluctuation that has been occurring on the graduation markings. So on the depending on the direction of moving, you might get the direction with the movement might be with respect to the clockwise direction, or it might be with respect to anti-clockwise direction also. So now what we do is nothing but we used to increase the height to the certain extent using the slip gauge, and we'll make this conical surface itself as perfectly parallel to the horizontal surface. So by that case, if at all we want to move the dial indicator on the top of that, there won't be any kind of fluctuations. We shall take the combination of slip gauge now, then we'll go by the trial and error method, then we'll look upon either the surface is exactly parallel or not. Right, so now we have the combination of slip gauge here that has been taken for the approximate height. So we have taken the three combination of slip gauge here for 20 mm, 5.5 mm and as well as 2 mm. So for that slip gauge, we have mounted upon the sine center here, and we have the dial indicator on the top of that. So if you can able to observe the readings upon the dial indicator here, so let me take an initial condition now. It has been raised to the certain extent, and at the initial diameter, it is the set value itself is zero. Suppose if I have to move the dial indicator to the certain length over the period of duration here, if you can able to observe the deviation that has been occurring on the graduation markings. So there is a slight amount of deflection that has been there. Means to say, you still have to compensate the height with respect to the horizontal surface. So we have the second combination of slip gauge now. With a trial and error method, we have come to the combination of 20, 5.5, 2, and as well we have taken the other two combination of slip gauge with respect to 1.13 and as well as 0.5. So totally that accounts to the overall approximate height of 29.13. So we'll take the readings now. We'll look upon what might be the deflection that might be occur on the dial indicator. Okay, we have the different combination of slip gauge now. So for the first trial, we have taken the approximate height itself as 25.759. So for that trial, we have got the different amount of deflection. And next, we have taken the next trial with respect to the different combination here, 20 plus 2 plus 2.75. And we have got the deflection of 0.88. Like that, we have taken the different trial and error. By trial and error method, we have taken the different combination of slip gauge. And at the last, we have come to the conclusion that for 20 plus 2 plus 2.75 plus 1.5 plus 1 plus 0.5, we had got the zero deflection. So that we can take it as actual height. So that can be substituted in the formula. Theta actual is equal to sine inverse of H actual divided by LC. So by substituting the values of 27.75 for the actual height, and the LC being the 200 mm, so we'll get the theta actual itself as 7.9 degree. So you can observe that for the theta approximate value that we had got as 7.4, and theta actual value by actual calculation we had got the value of 7.9. So that is how we find the unknown angle with respect to the taper for conical surface of specimen. So likewise, we can able to find out the angle for the different amount of tapered surfaces also. So this is the ultimate result of sine center.